We're just out for the day.
Yeah,
having a good time.
I'm gonna be 71 now.
Wow.
Well, they took me. That's a minnow.
Future state records.
We hope for.
They're all largemouth bass, huh?
Yep.
And
what hatchery are they out of?
Fairport Hatchery over by Muscatine on the Mississippi River.
How many thousand are you putting in?
I think it's about 70. I remember correctly. 150 pounds worth.
Wow.
That's a lot of largemouth.
It is a lot of largemouth.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So how many people work at the hatchery there?
At our hatchery, there's two full-time people. We have the biologist and myself as a technician, and then we usually get seasonal people, but not always. So we got two full-time people. There's 18 ponds there. It's a very old hatchery. It was built in, was started in 1908. So.
And so what all do you rear at the hatchery over there?
We do river strain walleye, largemouth bass, and we do all the bass and bluegill for the state of the hatchery.
Any other interesting information about the hatchery or history?
It was actually originally built as place to research and rear freshwater mussels. In the early 1800s, they were using freshwater mussels on the Mississippi River for button manufacturing. A man came over from Germany, and he named Biopel was his last name, and he pioneered a process of using the mussel shells in the river to actually make buttons. And so they actually were taking a lot of the population of mussels out of the Mississippi, because you needed a lot of mussels for as many buttons as people needed back then, since they didn't have plastic. So the federal government set up the hatchery to rear mussels, and in order to rear mussels you have to have fish, because what they do is they actually will have, they'll use their mantle to make a lure, and when the fish bite on it, then they inject the gills with their glaucidia, and so they attach to the gills, and then they will fall off later on as they get a little bit larger. So they were rearing fish and to put the mussels on, and researching how well that was done. And then in about the 20s and 30s, they switched over to almost entirely fish production because of the invention of plastic, and just they weren't able to produce enough mussels to counteract how many were being taken out. So they went over to mussel production, and the state took over it, or went into fish production. The state took over in the 1970s, and we've had it ever since. But kind of a cool thing is that we're actually kind of going back to the historical stuff, because there's a lot of endangered species of mussels on the river, and they're trying to do mussel mitigation projects. And as part of that, we're holding fish over for the federal government. There's a hatchery in Wisconsin, Genoa National Hatchery, that's doing a lot of the mussel production, and we've held fish for them. We've actually tried to house some mussels and stuff there for them as well. And there's a big mussel bed right out in front of the hatchery that they've used for adults for propagation purposes as well. So kind of neat, kind of going full circle in the process. So.
Well, that's good to hear.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Oh yeah, they'll be fine. Actually, it's probably better for them, because then they won't get eaten by all the crappies and everybody else that's out there. They can hide a little bit better when it's higher up.
You give them out to farm ponds and stuff?
Yeah, our hatchery does the farm pond program. So.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
Where are you at?
Muscatine.
Oh, clear down there. Right there.
Muscatine does the entire state for bass and bluegill.
Oh, they do?
Oh, yeah. Yep. Housing for over there, but we have a surplus this year of bass. We just did extra good this year, so we figured we called people and said, who wants them?
Some of the guys are going to ask about bringing water from Muscatine up here.
Yeah. The hatchery that we are out of, we do use water from the Mississippi River. They did some research when they first started having beaver mussels on the river as to methods of how to kill them. You can't kill the adults, but you can get to kill the free swimming villager form of them. And so what we do is we actually have sand filters and also sock filters that we use to get the majority of everything out. The sand filters will filter down and get a lot of the stuff out, and we actually deal with two sand filters. And then after they go through sand filters, they go through a 25 micron filter and a 10 micron sock filter. And the smaller size they've seen the villagers down to is about 40 to 50 microns. So you get most of them out by that, but we also go ahead then and treat the water with a potassium chloride, which can kill the villagers. We treat them for an hour with that, and then we also will add formalin, and we will treat for 2 hours with formalin. And then just as an added precaution, we don't drain our water. A lot of the hatcheries, they'll just stick a tube and drain right off into the lake source. We actually will drain our net the fish off and then go ahead and drain into an area where the water has time to go through more filtering with the grass and stuff. Just as an extra precaution, we go ahead and do that. So, and we've been doing it since in the 1990s sometime, and there's been no record of any of the places that we've stocked having beaver mussels in them. There are some places that got them, but they came on with boats and stuff like that, and it's not areas that we've personally stocked. So apparently the method must work pretty good. There was a lot of research done on it when beaver mussels first came out.
Well, thank you very much.
Yeah, no problem.
Okay, if you could tell me how you got interested in conservation work and how you went about your education and all of that, I'd sure appreciate it.
Well, I grew up as a fisherman and a hunter. My grandparents and my father had a big part to play in that, so I've been doing both of those activities since I could pull a rod or a gun. So I've always known that I wanted to go into science or ecology. First, I wanted to be a vet, then I wanted to be a biologist and a zoologist, and I finally decided on becoming a fisheries professional just because I love fishing, and when you do fisheries work, you would be fishing otherwise, so it's a really good time. I decided to go to Iowa State University because I live in Iowa. They have one of the best ecology programs in the nation, in my opinion, and they have a great staff. There's all sorts of hands-on activities to do, and I learned a lot there. If you want to go in the fisheries field, I would advise that you plan on taking on a master's degree as well, just to increase your understanding and to get more experience in the field before you enter the job market.
Okay, and how many years does it take to those degrees?
4 years for your bachelor's degree in animal ecology at Iowa State. I think that's pretty standard. Master's programs probably vary quite a bit. I think the standard is 2 years. Usually you'll get into a position underneath a professor who has a research project to do, and then you go out and do the field work and design a study and write the papers and get results.
And what are you working on now?
I'm working with the Iowa DNR through the AmeriCorps program. It's a summer of fisheries aid. So I am helping with stocking lakes, netting fish, stocking fish and maintaining equipment.
And so you're based out of...
I'm based out of the Boone Wildlife Research Station in Boone, Iowa.
Oh, at the Ledges?
Yep.
Okay.
Ledges Park.
Okay.
There's a lot of good folks there, too. There's a very large staff of wildlife research and fisheries folks there.
Okay.
Great place to work.
Anything else you can think of that...
Experience.
Just get all the experience.
Get into an internship, volunteer. Find anything you can that's in your field that'll help you out. And don't just find jobs in your field. If it's during the school year and you can get a job doing construction or anything to broaden your horizons is definitely what it takes to be successful as you go on after college.
Well, thank you very much. And what is your name?
My name's Keegan Richmond.
Keegan, nice to meet you.
Yep.
Thank you.
Have a good one.